Good morning. How are you today? Good. I thought I would start with some show and tell this morning because I have learned that not only kindergartners love show and tell. I have some of the clothes that I wore in the jungle. And it's sort of tradition that I show them, show and tell, if there's time. So we'll take the time today. Several days after my rescue, these were delivered to the American Embassy in Manila. I don't even know how they knew they were mine, but here they are, and I thought I'd show them to you. When Martin and I were taken hostage, we were at a resort celebrating our anniversary, which is a very embarrassing thing for a missionary to have to say. We weren't busy in the jungle, we were at a resort. Wish I could change that. Martin was a jungle pilot for New Tribes Mission. New Tribes Mission has recently changed their name, I think you know that, Ethnos 360 now. Ethnos 360 works in remote areas where no roads go. So think of everything that you use in a month for your family. Well, they don't have that in the jungle. So think of all the groceries and the homeschool stuff and stuff from the drugstore, whatever you're going to need for a month. Our job was to buy that for you. You would tell me on the radio what you needed. I would buy it for you, box it up, put it on your shelf in the hangar, and Martin's job was to bring it in to you during your flight. We did that for 16 years, and we loved our job. Our children were born in the Philippines. And our mission agency, New Tribes Mission Aviation, Ethnos 360 Aviation now, asked Martin if he would become the chief pilot of our organization worldwide. Well, we didn't want that job, because that meant we would have to move back to the United States. We wanted to stay in the Philippines. So Martin went back to our headquarters in Arizona and talked with the guys there. And on his way back to the Philippines, he got a call from our pilot on the island of Palawan, letting him know that that pilot's father had just died. He was going to have to go home to a funeral. Would Martin take his flying? Well, Martin was happy to do that. He called me and he said, "Gracia, I can't come home. I've got to go fly for Jerry." And I knew that Martin would need help. So I cleared my schedule and I gave our children the choice. Do you want to come with me to Palawan or do you want to stay here with our neighbors, our coworkers? They chose to stay with the neighbors. So I told them, "We'll be home in 1 week." I knew that Martin would need some naps because of the jet lag from crossing the Pacific. So I called our coworkers on Palawan and said, "Where's a good place where we could go? Martin needs some naps. We don't even have to be there 24 hours, just a place to rest." And they said, "Oh, Dos Palmas, you'll get lots of rest there." Then they told us the cost, and it was too much money. And it was on the tip of my tongue to say, "You know, we'll just get a little place in town." But I thought, oh, our anniversary is right around the corner. That's how I justified the cost. And we got out to Dos Palmas, a beautiful island resort, white sand beaches. We had a nice meal, went out in the kayaks and looked at the starfish, went to bed that night. Early the next morning before dawn, there was a pounding on the door. Bang, 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 and I thought it might be a drunk guard because that had happened to us before at resorts in the Philippines. And Martin grabbed some shorts, and even before he got to the door, these three guys with M16s broke the door in, and one of them took him right out. One of them came over to the bed, and he lowered his weapon at me and yelled, "Go, go, go." And I said, "No, no, no." I'm not dressed properly. I grabbed the closest thing to me, what we'd worn to the beach the night before, cut off shorts and a t-shirt, and they took me out too. And they were emptying all of the cottages built on stilts out over the water, taking us to a waiting speedboat. And as we pulled away from the dock, they raised their weapons in the air and yelled, "Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar." And that's when we knew who had us. Everyone in the Philippines knows who the Abu Sayyaf are. They're militant Muslims who've declared jihad in that area of the world, but their jihad has really degenerated into a kidnap for ransom group, and we knew we were in big trouble. The other thing I knew was if these were Muslims who just burst in, I wasn't dressed properly. You know how they keep their Muslim women totally covered? And I had on shorts and a t-shirt. And one of my first prayers was that I would have something decent to wear. That evening, they transferred us from that speedboat to a fishing vessel so we would have more room. And as we got on the fishing vessel, one of the guys threw this malong at me. A malong is a long piece of batik material that's been sewn up the middle to make a tube, and this became my skirt. If you were to go to the marketplace in the Philippines, you would see lots of women wearing these, not just Muslim women. You know, you might even see a man or two. I never got used to seeing 18-year-old guys with M16s walking through the jungle with a skirt on. That didn't make any sense to me. This was my most prized possession. That first night on the boat, this was my blanket. This was my changing room when they would allow us to go to the river for a bath. And I told you about a bath last night. We would step into the stream or the river with all our clothes on. We would get ourselves wet. If we had soap, we would soap up under our clothes and we would rinse off and we would drip dry, unless we had a change of clothes. And sometimes the guys would order things for us and we would have something clean to put on, but then we would lose everything in gun battles. You know, you would drop your stuff and run, and we would be back to the clothes on our backs again. If after a bath I had something dry to put on, they weren't going to let me go find a private place to change because they thought I might not come back. And they were right. So I just got in this, and I would get this in my teeth so my hands were free, and I would, you know, take my wet stuff off and put it in a pile and get my dry stuff and put it on. And sometimes it was awkward and you got stuck. It probably looked like a Mr. Bean sketch at times, but it worked. This was our towel, of course, at the river. This was my bathroom. I had the same problem every time I needed to use the bathroom because they weren't going to let me go find a private place. So I learned to just get in this and step off the trail in front of God and everybody and get this in my teeth. So my hands were free, and squat there and do what I needed to do. Well, I'd never done that before. And the first few times you try that, you don't hit where you're aiming. This would be a messy malong till we got to the next river where we could wash it out. This was my suitcase. When we were first taken hostage, we didn't have a backpack or anything. And the guys who were out on duty would come running in, "Sundalo, Sundalo, soldiers, soldiers, pack up." And we would grab everything we owned at the time and throw it into the middle of the malong and tie up the inside ends so things didn't fall out, and just throw it over our shoulder and we would run. This was our backpack. This was our stretcher. Martin died in our 17th gun battle. And in those gun battles, there would be dead. There would be wounded that they needed to deal with till we could get to a Muslim village where they could handle the problem. So the first thing they would do after a gun battle is chop down a tree. Andrea was kind enough to find me a poor excuse for a tree. We've just chopped this down. You know, you've just been in a gun battle. The military's pursuing you, and they stop to chop down a tree like they're not going to hear that and come running. They would thread the malong onto the tree. the wounded guy would lay down in the middle. One guy would get on this end, one guy would get on that end, and they would just carry him for days, for weeks through the jungle, however long it took. This was my Kleenex when I sat around crying, which was every day. I always felt sorry for myself. I always wished this weren't happening to me. I always missed my kids. And you know, when you cry, your nose runs. This was a great big hanky. They saw that it was difficult to run through the jungle with a skirt on, so they started ordering what they called pantos. These are kind of like pajama bottoms. These would come into the camp. The guys would snatch up the dark green, the dark brown, the things that would camouflage well. They would get those things. They would give the light color clothes to us hostages, so we would make a good target for the military if we were in a gun battle. We were happy to have these. These are thin. They never kept the mosquitoes from biting right through them. I needed a long sleeve shirt, and I asked God for one. After one of our first gun battles, my guard, his name was Sakaki, he came running into the camp and he said, ma'am, over in that farmer's hut, I found this shirt for you. And he held up the ugliest shirt that I'd ever seen. Psychedelic designs, loud colors, flowers all over it. I thought, I will be the target. I said, Sakaki, someone else needs that shirt. He said, no, it's for you. And I wore that for a long time until one day Lokman gave me this shirt when he got a new one. I was so thankful for this. It was heavy. It was hot for the tropics. But I liked it because the sleeves were long enough. They even covered my fingertips. I was trying to keep every inch of me covered. I think the most important thing to them that I wore was my head covering. They called this a tudrong. I wore my head covering all the time, even when I slept. I was just trying to do the right thing. This is not the one I wore in the jungle. I don't know where that one went. I saw this one in the marketplace and I got it because it was pretty. I kept my turong on all the time, but they were always after me to stick my hair up under my head covering. You know, if you haven't had a bath in 4 weeks, your hair is going to be icky and stringy, hanging in your face, and the guys were always after me. And I thought they didn't like my blonde hair. I found out later, they believe for every hair that sticks out from under your head covering, that's how many thousands of years you will spend in hell. Well, I don't plan on going to hell. Could I take a few minutes to just go over maybe what Muslims believe for a few minutes, because God keeps bringing the Muslim world to our attention when we turn on the TV or watch the news. Right now it's the Iranian students that are uniting and protesting after a young Muslim girl got picked up because some of her hair was showing under her headdress, and the police picked her up and beat her to death. And so Iranian students are all protesting and trying to get the government to loosen some of their harshness. So let's learn a bit about them. We'll look at some things we have in common with Muslims, and we'll look at some of the differences. And Islam is the religion of the Muslim. Muslims are the people, Islam's the religion. So I don't want those terms to confuse you. And before I even start, I'm going to make a disclaimer. I don't want you to think that I think I'm an expert on Islam, because I am not. All I know is what I learned from living with them for a year. When we were first taken, they transferred us from that speedboat to the fishing vessel that they commandeered, and it was dusk. The sun was setting, so it was time for evening prayer. Muslims are required to pray 5 times a day facing Mecca, and that was one of the first problems that evening. Which direction was Mecca? Because if you don't pray towards Mecca, your prayers don't count, and that's very important. We were out on the ocean. There was a lot of talk and shoulder shrugging. They got it figured out and started their ritualistic bowing down. And I asked Martin, are they praying to the same God we're praying to? And Martin said, I have no idea. So we started to listen and talk with them about their ideas of God. And here's what they told us. They believe Allah made everything. He is sovereign. He's almighty. He's all-knowing. He's the judge. He's the greatest. There's none greater. He hears and answers prayer. He's merciful. He's the provider. That sounded a whole lot like Jehovah God to me. But then there were some things that didn't sound like our God, Jehovah God. You can bribe Allah. He plays favorites. He changes his mind a lot. You can follow all his rules, and he doesn't have to allow you into paradise. And everybody hopes that Allah is in a good mood on judgment day. Well, we know who the true God is, don't we? Because we know him personally. His spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're his children. And we know who the true God is because his name is the name above every name. And at the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow. So they have 100 names for God. Mankind knows 99 of them. They wear a rosary around their necks, a string of beads that represent the names of God. And they pray the rosary. There are 99 beads for the known names of God, and then there's a special one at the bottom for the unknown name, the 100th name of God, the one no one knows. Have you noticed that a camel is smiling? A camel has a big smile on his face. Do you know why? He knows the 100th name of God, but he's not telling. It's a secret. One day I asked one of the guys, hey, is one of your names for Allah love? And he thought for a minute and he said, no, Allah doesn't love us and we don't love him either. We just do what he tells us to do because he's Allah, he's God. And I thought, oh, I know the 100th name for God. God is love. We have a lot of the same important people in our beliefs. Prophets, they call them. They know all about Adam, Abraham, Moses, Elijah, David. David, that's a freaky one. David was a great mujahideen, a great holy warrior. What did David do when he killed Goliath? He chopped his head off. That's what those guys would do. When we would come to a village and they wanted to gain control or make a point, they would separate a few guys off to the side and chop their heads off. David was a great holy warrior. Jesus, they know all about Jesus. Jesus was the promised one, born of a miraculous birth, who would be the savior of the world. They believe that at the end of time, Jesus will come to earth again riding a white horse. Have you ever heard that? That's in our scripture. There will be a battle called Armageddon, and Jesus will judge the world. That's in our scripture too. But do you know who Jesus is coming to judge? He's going to judge those of us who believe that he was God. Because he wasn't God, they say. He was just a mighty prophet. And after Jesus came the final and the mightiest prophet, and his name was Muhammad. Here's a big difference. Islam, they told us, is all about justice, We want justice for every bad thing that has ever happened to a Muslim, and they go really far back in history because they say Allah is a God of justice and we need to help him get that. Martin would tell them, I guess the gospel, what we believe, is all about mercy. We need someone to have mercy on us, because if we get justice, we're all in big trouble. Martin quoted some verses one day to Sulaiman, one of the leaders of the group. Because of his mercies, we're not consumed. Because of his great mercy, he saved us. And Sulaiman said with a sneer, well, where's the justice in a religion like that? I said, you know, Sulaiman, we've all agreed that we're all sinners and that God's going to judge our sin. We believe God provided someone to pay for our sin. Jesus came to pay for our sins so we don't have to. And Sulaiman said, I'll pay for my own sin. Several years ago, on my birthday, the phone rang early in the morning at my house. I thought it might be one of my sisters in another time zone calling to wish me happy birthday, but it was the Associated Press. They wanted a statement from me. It seems that that very morning, a leader of the Abu Sayyaf had been killed in a gun battle with the military. Their name, they said, Sulaiman. Well, first of all, my first thought was, what are the chances of that happening on my birthday? It's like God tapped me on the shoulder and said, Gracia, I have not forgotten you. And my next thought was Sulaiman's words, I'll pay for my own sin. And that's what Sulaiman is doing today. And that was my statement to the Associated Press, that I was so sad that Sulaiman started paying for his own sin that day, and the importance of having a sin bearer. Aren't you glad you have a sin bearer? We might have some problems today, but our sin problem doesn't have to be one of them. Here's something that is the same if you are comparing Islam and Christianity. Muslims believe that everyone has sinned and that God will judge everyone, and I'll tell you about the judgment here in just a minute. If God says so, you'll go to heaven. If God says so, you'll go to hell. And everybody agreed, no one wants to go to hell. And that's why there are so many terrorists. The only way for a Muslim to be absolutely sure of going to heaven when they die is if they die in jihad, in holy war. Holy warriors bypass the iffy judgment of God and they go straight to paradise. And that's what makes them willing to strap explosives on their backs and blow up buses or themselves. That's how they can go straight to heaven. Here's a difference. Muslims believe that they can work their way to heaven. That's why they pray 5 times a day. They have fasting days. They give alms to the poor. They wear the right clothes and the head coverings. They eat the right foods. They follow all the rules in hopes that, here's their belief about the judgment. They believe that at the end of all time, everyone who's ever been born will stand in a long line beside each other waiting to be judged, and will stand in the posture that they begin their praying in, and will stand totally naked for 40,000 years. We'll stand that way. When we can't bear it anymore, we start going to the prophets. We'll go to Adam. Adam, go to Allah, ask him to judge us. We don't want to do this anymore. And Adam will say, I can't go to Allah. I'm not worthy. Then they'll find Abraham. Abraham, go to Allah. Ask him to judge us. We can't bear this anymore. And Abraham will say, I can't go to Allah. I'm not worthy. They'll go prophet to prophet. Moses, Elijah, David, Jesus. They'll all say, I'm not worthy. And then they'll find Muhammad. And Muhammad will go to Allah and convince him that it's time to judge mankind. And Allah will take all your good things, your praying five times a day, wearing the right clothes, eating the right foods, giving alms to the poor. He'll weigh that against your sin. If your good outweighs your bad, you go to paradise. If your bad outweighs your good, you go to hell. Isn't that what a lot of Americans believe? Don't a lot of your friends and neighbors think that God has this cosmic scale up in heaven, and he's putting all your good things on one side and all your bad things on another, and you hope that at the end of time your good outweighs your bad? You know what scripture says, right? If there's one thing on your bad side, you can't enter heaven. God's holy. He will not look on sin. And that was the point. When Jesus died, he took our sin on himself. But he didn't just take our sin, he traded us something for it. He took our sin and gave back to us his righteousness. 2 Corinthians 5:21 puts it so well. He who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. We are totally forgiven because of what Jesus did. And that's something a Muslim can never know, how it feels to know that you're forgiven. That's basically the end of Muslim school, except to say one thing. Let's not be afraid of Muslims, because when you're afraid of something, you stay as far away from them as you can, right? When you see a lady in the store in her burqa, she and you have a whole lot in common. Mostly, she wants the same thing you do. A good home, a peaceful place to live, a place where her children can thrive. And who knows but what God is working in that lady's heart, making her wish for something to fill the vacuum that she feels in her soul. If we don't reach out to Muslims and befriend them, how are they ever going to hear the gospel? They say there are Muslims who've been in the United States for 10, 15 years, and they've never been invited into an American home. Some say they've never even had a meaningful conversation with an American. Makes us uncomfortable. And I get it. I'm right there with you. The gospel is the power of God to salvation for the Muslim as well. But it's not likely that we'll ever get to share the gospel with them if we don't build a relationship with them. God's bringing the nations to our doorstep. So as you come across them, ask God what he would have you do. Maybe you can move out of your comfort zone and show them some hospitality. If we look at Muslims with fear and shy away from them, we won't be a witness to them. I spoke in Independence, Missouri once at a ladies' meeting much like this one, and a lady came up to me and said, "Gracia, in the last few weeks, I have just had this burden for Muslims, and I don't know what to do with it. And why would I have that? I don't even know any Muslims, and I'm busy. I've got little children. I'm not going to go find Muslims. Why do I have this burden?" And I said, "Well, let's pray. Let's pray and find out why." One morning, she sent me an email. She was running to the grocery store for milk. She forgot to get it the day before. Don't you hate that? And there, laying in the road at the stop sign, was a wallet, just laying there. She got out, picked it up, looked at the ID, and saw that the man it belonged to looked like his name might be Muslim. She took the wallet to that address, and sure enough, they were a Muslim family. They were beside themselves at the missing wallet, and they were so grateful for her. And then the next few days, she prayed, and she took him a fruit basket. The next few days, took him some flowers. She was planning to keep on befriending them and invite them for Thanksgiving dinner so they can see what goes on in an American home at Thanksgiving. Parades and football games and turkey. Let God use you. Maybe it could be you that gets to see a Muslim find out what it means to be forgiven. Well, you guys know how our story went, how for months it looked like our release was right around the corner, and then something would happen, and negotiations would break down again, and we would be back to square one again, and how that went on for what seemed like forever to us, and you know how Martin died in the gun battle that rescued me. But I got to come home and raise my children. Can I tell you about the kids? I think we have photos. As you can see, they're grown now. I think my kids would say that raising children overseas is one of the world's best kept secrets. We loved our life overseas. And as we brought our kids along, as we ministered, they developed soft hearts for the world. They've seen firsthand the absolute change that the gospel can bring in a people group, and they got to be part of that. All the kids love the Lord. The one on the right is a UPS pilot. He does a lot of Asia flying because he loves Asia, and sometimes he gets to go to the Philippines. My daughter Mindy, she and her husband are in ministry in Tampa, and Zach lives in Kansas City. And the next one is one of those rare occasions that we were together for family vacation, VBS. That's what happens when you're in ministry. Everybody gets together for VBS. And the next one is me and my grandchildren. Minus two, Lottie and Edmund are not in that picture. I need new pictures because they're just babies. Anyway, my kids and I have asked people like you all over the world to pray for our captors. And why are we surprised when God does something wonderful and answers our prayer? I don't know. Oh, me of little faith. God's given me a rest of the story. Several years ago, an American couple that works in prison ministry in the Philippines contacted me. They had gotten a hold of a comic book series that our foundation printed. 13 comic books on the lives of the prophets, those men that Muslims believe to be prophets: Adam, Abraham, Moses, Elijah, David, on through Jesus. I have a few of them. We printed them in the Tausug language, which was the language that many of the Abu Sayyaf spoke. And we were so happy. They're beautiful. They're colorful. I have no idea what they say. They're in Tausug. I trust that they're right. They gave the comics away in the prison, and the guys loved them. They said, anything else you print, we want to read. But they said, the interesting thing that's happening here in the prison is these guys found out Gracia Burnham printed these. Some of them are coming to us saying, we're former Abu Sayyaf. We're the ones who held them captive. I said, well, ask them their names. Maybe I know them. Sure enough, here came the names. Guys we lived with, hiked with, starved with, 23 or so of them there for the rest of their lives. There's Zacharias, who on May 27 burst into our room at Dos Palmas with his M16. He was so surprised to find out that our youngest son and him had the same name, Zacharias, that we would name one of our children after one of their Muslim prophets. And we just let him think that. Daoud is in prison, the guy that used to sit and talk with Martin when we would rest during our long days of hiking. Daoud's job was to carry the solar panels through the jungle. The solar panels would help charge the sat phones and the cell phones so they could talk to the outside government negotiators. Daoud's wife and child had died in childbirth. And since the economy is horrible in the southern Philippines where he lives, he found himself with no family, no means of support. He joined the Abu Sayyaf almost as a career move. Martin and Daoud would sit and discuss all sorts of things, from jihad, holy war, to being shaheed, being martyred. They discussed Daoud's hopes and dreams. They talked about whether Jesus really raised from the dead or not. For a long time they talked about that, until one day Daoud just went missing. He was gone, and word came back that he got arrested by the military when he was out on another island doing a secret arms deal. Also in jail is Bashir. We called him Bus for short. He was shot in the same gun battle that Martin died in, the one that led to my rescue. Bashir was unable to keep up with the group as they retreated down the river, so they left him behind to fend for himself in the jungle with 500 pesos, $10. You can't buy anything in the jungle. You can't take care of yourself. And several days later, the military found him. Gangrene had moved into his leg. It had to be amputated. He sends me notes every once in a while. Would you want to hear the first note I ever got from Bashir? We had to get it translated, of course. It was written in his dialect. It says, "I am Bas. I, Bas, wrote you to ask you how you are. How about you there, Gracia? I'm here now at maximum security, and my foot was cut off. Do you still remember the experiences we had?" Like, no. Sounds like summer camp. Remember that? "I still remember every time I cook food, I cook eel good." He did cook eel good. At one point, we were starving, and we came across a mountain stream that had eel in it. And the guys crafted fish traps from stuff they harvested in the jungle, and they caught the eel. And for several days, that's what we ate, and Bas was the cook. "Everything you said, I will never forget. Even though I'm here in jail, I has no fault." Yeah, right. He's the kid that one day chopped a guy's head off, came up the hill with blood spattered all over his yellow t-shirt. No fault indeed. "I also told you, when I am free, I will go with you to America. But my dreams did not go through. My dream was to become a businessman, but it did not materialize because I'm in jail. It's difficult to be in jail. It's very hot here, and it's pitiful here, and no one visits me here. I want to see you if you have a picture to send me. Take care always." And he signs it, "Your friend." The letters aren't the only things I've received from the prison. I have this shirt that Will and Joni gave me, signed by some of the guys in the prison. It says, "Inmate Maximum." I said, "Will and Joni, what am I supposed to do with this t-shirt? You can't wear it to the mall." This couple and I get together to figure out ways to show the love of Christ to these guys. And I wish I had an hour to tell you that story, fixing their roof so they don't get rained on and so there's not a muddy floor. Just things. These guys are reading the scriptures in their own dialects. I told them last night there were 6 or 7 different languages being spoken amongst them. They've asked for scriptures in their own dialects. Some are going to Bible studies. I'm supporting some of the poorest of the poor, so they have some means of buying soap so they can take a bath or wash their clothes. And some of the ideas we come up with, we don't even know if they're good. You know, we're just asking God to bless our meager efforts, and he has. So far, 5 former Abu Sayyaf that we know of have come to know the Lord as their Savior. One of them, a very violent man, with over 20 counts of murder against him, a new person in Christ, a brother in the Lord. The most recent that we know of isn't even in the prison. A pastor in a remote place in the Philippines sent word to me that one of the former leaders of the Abu Sayyaf has moved into his area. The whole family has come to know the Lord. They're trying to live a quiet life and grow in their faith for as long as he can, because someday someone's going to realize who he is and he needs to pay for his crimes. And we just keep praying. And I wonder if you'd want to pray too when you think of me and my story. Pray especially for Zachary, who's very hard and resistant towards anything having to do with the gospel. God can do anything, can't he? And it's not over till it's over. And I think God's let me be a small part of what's going on there just to encourage me, because he loves doing good things for his children. Had I known while we were going through our hard year in the jungle that one day even one of those guys would come to know Jesus because of our experience, I think the days would have been easier to bear. And I could kick myself now and say, would it not have been enough to trust a good God with the days of my life? Can we begin to believe that God takes us into hard situations not to crush us, but so that we can learn to see his hand and learn to trust him when he's doing a good work? And God's work is good. What he's doing in the midst of the mess is good, because he's good. And I've been encouraged that there can't be a harvest without seed planters. And maybe planting seeds isn't always fun. Maybe planting seeds for you is downright uncomfortable and you don't see any fruit for your labors. You might wonder why you were called to plant seeds, because you're not even good at it. But all of a sudden you see what God's doing. And I've been reminded that the seed we planted in the jungle wasn't wasted. Others are reaping what we sowed ever so long ago. So keep planting those seeds, my friend, those seeds of the gospel that Christ died for our sins, the ones that God said will never be wasted. Keep on when you feel like giving up, when you don't see any fruit, when you don't know what you're doing. Just keep on. It's God that's going to do the work on down the road. Our theme for the conference is Grace Under Fire. And I told you the impact that Hebrews 12:1 had on my life when I saw that showing grace and kindness to an enemy or anyone who's undeserving isn't a natural thing. And when I was so angry, God used the words of Scripture, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race set before us, looking unto Jesus. We throw off the weights. God's desire for us is to be as free as possible from anything that weighs us down from living a life of service to others, because living that kind of life brings glory to God. In our Christian walk, Paul encourages us to strip away anything that might prevent us from living an abundant life. How do we do that? We keep our eyes on Jesus. He will show us those things that are hindering us. Jesus is the author of our faith. He's the one who initiates our relationship with him. We didn't go out seeking for God, did we? In fact, Scripture says that before we come to know the Lord, we're enemies of God. And that offends some people. I'm not God's enemy. What else the Bible says is that people who don't know the Lord are dead in their sins. And we've all been there, haven't we? I talk with a lot of people on airplanes about the Lord, and they say things like, sure, I'm a Christian. I think I know right from wrong. I have a Bible, but I don't really understand it. The only time I pray is when I have a situation that I can't handle myself, and it's not all that often. I don't really understand a lot of what you're talking about. Well, when you're dead in your sins, that's how the Scriptures describe a person. who's not a Christian, when you're dead, you can't think, you can't understand, you can't move. You can't do anything to change the fact that you're dead. But the Spirit gives life. You've heard today that we've all sinned. There's no one righteous enough to merit God's favor. And that means we can't enter heaven. Only those with clean hearts can be in God's presence. So we have a problem, don't we? We have a sin problem. Here's the solution. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Christ came to earth and died for our sins. He was buried, and he rose again the third day, just like the scripture says he did. So the gift of eternal life is offered to us because of what Jesus did for us. The Bible says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them who believe on his name. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Becoming a child of God is not a long, lengthy, hard to understand process. It's like when you're sitting at the computer and this question pops up and you're asked to hit the button to accept it or decline it. The question for you today is, will you receive the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ? And you can accept it and say, yes, I do accept that gift, or you can decline the offer. When you push the accept button, when you say yes, that's what we call becoming a Christian. When I became a Christian, I had someone help lead me in a prayer so I would know how to do that. And that's helpful for some people. And I was thinking, if there's anyone here today that doesn't know the Lord, but you're ready to accept Christ's sacrifice for you personally, I wondered if I could lead us in a prayer. And if that's you, you can take advantage of someone helping you pray as well. So let's bow our heads. And if you're ready to accept Christ's sacrifice for you, would you silently pray this prayer? I'll pray a phrase, you repeat it in your mind and your heart, and it isn't the choice of words that's important here, it's the decision that you're making. God in heaven, I know that I'm a sinner and I need help. I can't take care of my own sin problem. I know that Jesus died to take away my sin. I accept his sacrifice for myself right now. I want to be one of your children. Thank you for being my Savior. Please teach me to live for you. Amen. Well, let's lift our heads. And if you've made that decision to accept Christ just now, we are so happy for you. We think it would be great if you would tell someone about that today. Maybe the person who brought you or someone with a name tag today. They'll be so happy and you will never regret that decision. If you have questions today, please come to us and ask those. Or go to the Lord and just say, God, would you make yourself real to me? Just like a lot of these women, you're real to them, and I would like that. God will meet you where you are because he loves you.